curious, how many people here have made the gospel series? That's a pretty good chunk. The number seems to be going down in the recent history, and it's kind of interesting why. What I'm talking about tonight is advances in technology available to people and how it can impact making telescopes. So, who originally started ATM? Russell Porter founded the Telescope Makers of Vermont, Springfield, Vermont, in 1923, and started an observatory up there called, it's in an area, and they have an event called Stellafane. It's the first star party ever. That group really founded the amateur telescope making. Has anybody been to Stellafane before? If you're an amateur telescope maker, that's where you want to go. It's a humbling experience. You will see telescopes that are you've never seen before and you'll never see again. Those guys are really fantastic opticians and machinists. They're a little on the stuck up side. They got a machinist and they don't like the guy. And there's a few going. We do have members of the club that have built telescopes and won awards there, which is no small achievement. Why do we build telescopes? Guys who talk to, what were your reasons that you wanted to make your own telescope?
Is that good?
Well, there you go. That's the satisfaction part down here on the end. anybody else? Hello? Yeah?
I got to make all the design decisions, and I knew it'd be easier to fix one I built than one I bought.
Yep. That's the main reason I did it, because you can design the telescope you want and not be constrained by the ones that were available to buy. 90% of the telescopes I built were designed for traffic. Seeing conditions, yourself. You have to take it somewhere. My 24-inch dot I built was specifically designed to go in the back of a Subaru Forester, which was no small achievement. It was a quarter-inch clearance on both sides. Like, that opened the windows and let air out and pushed it in. it was tight, particularly when you had camping gear, ladders, children. My children were four. And the second one is to enhance and improve existing commercial telescopes. And I believe, in protecting your investment, I believe that is where most of the ATM work will be in the future. How many people have commercial SETs? Now, telescopes don't wear out, but electronics do. And how many of those SETs that you've invested thousands of dollars in are going to be working in 20 years? I don't have many pieces of electronics that are still working well after 20 years. And you don't know whether or not. The telescope industry has been in turmoil. Things, people go out of business, come back. How do you protect your investment? We're going to talk about that here, using the new technologies that are available to us. New advancements. Open source automation tools, electronics, and software. Open source is a movement that has been going on for, about 20 years since it first started. What it means is I'm going to write software, but it's going to be freely available for other people to use. It's a community-developed product or a group company. It can be a private company that develops the code. It's open source, which means you can have it free. You can have the source and maintain it yourself, but the companies make money if you want maintenance contracts and that sort of thing. That's kind of what open source is. But the open source licensing and stuff has opened up an avenue for a lot more innovation. automation tools, that includes open source development of 3D printers, the software that runs 3D printers, electronics. How many have heard of an Arduino? open source hardware. It's kind of at the core of a lot of what we're going to talk about now. It's a small controller that can run, well, look at that, and then the other thing that's important is the maker movement. What's the maker movement? It's a group of people that have decided to take things and innovate and repurpose and create. It's a creative movement of taking things that exist, repurposing them to make something new. 3D printers started in, with guys. So one of the original purposes, they took HP inkjet printers, emptied out the ink cartridges, filled them with cells, and changed the device and tried to print organs by spraying cells. It sounds far-fetched, but they now can print an organ. I don't think they've gotten one of them to actually work yet. But that was one of the earliest developments of 3D printing. There's a large commercial market for 3D printing, and the maker movement and the open source has brought those costs of those products down to where we can afford it in using. ATM in retrospect. We used to build telescopes. ATM was kind of a scrounging profession. Dobson would go out and get wood pallets from behind stores. He'd go get portholes from junkyards from ships to grind his mirrors. Much of what we used for building telescopes were common property. Most of them were lots of plumbing parts, PVC. The drain on a sink is 1.25-inch diameter. It makes a perfect focus point. You put in a block of wood, a piece of felt, and you slide it in and out. You've got a focus for a telescope. We had some, if you know Bob Bungie, he's one of our members. He's actually one of the original ATMers in the area. He's built a lot of telescopes. So you look at his, and all of them say Home Depot, because that's where he did the parts. So it was wood, glass, repurposing things, a lot of plumbing parts, lots of PVC, Teflon, taken from other items. And it was craft-based. You had to be reasonably proficient with a saw and a hammer, and you have basic carpentry skills to be able to build it up. So it doesn't take a lot of precision. The only thing you're really trying to do is get this mirror, that mirror, this focuser in the correct orientation and keep it there as you move it around. There's a lot of solutions to that problem. things don't have to be square, but light has to be bounced around correctly to make it work. precision isn't as big. Early telescopes as the early Dobsonians were, particularly John Dobson's, were called light buckets because what they did is just caught light and kind of focused it in a blob. It wasn't a complementary term. Years have improved greatly since that time. That moves us into what's new today, what topics. Home manufacturing is kind of a topic of what you can do. You can have the classic workshop outfitted with things you can buy at Sears. Wood is still perfectly good. All the old techniques are perfectly good. They can still make good telescopes. What this offers is new technologies for being able to do things or beyond your ability as of most people to do in the past. That includes 3D printing. Has anybody worked with 3D printers? CNC machines, computer numerical, and electronics. The electronics we're talking about are basically the open source small controllers that allow your device to communicate to the environment. A computer controller is basically an interface between the world around you and what you want to do. Okay, 3D printing is an active is an additive process, which means unlike a CNC mill where you take a piece of metal and carve out what you don't need in a part, you have a lot of waste coming out. 3D printing is an additive process where you start with a blank slate and you layer a layer of material and then you build another layer on top of that and another one on top of that. And what your product slowly grows from the bottom up as you go along. There's a lot of advantages to that. You can build things with 3D printing that are impossible to make any other way. It's possible to make parts that move. You can have gears and hubs that interlock and move when it's done. There's no assembly required to print the entire device in one motion. Yeah, it does it by layer, and traditionally you had to cut the parts. If you had to make more parts, you would make those separately, and then you have to bolt them together, and then you end up with a machine that has seams and stuff, and the things break, and you have seams, and you have to have gaskets. A 3D printer can make whole units that would normally be a dozen or more individual parts. SpaceX uses laser sintering to make rocket motors. They're, Merlin engines. I think it's his Merlin retros that he 3D prints. But he prints them and they're seamless, so that increases the reliability of rocket motors. There's no seams to break. Things usually break at glue points. You can create an entire rocket motor out of seams. Laser printer, stereolithography, digital light processing. Those two are basically built using a process where you have a liquid that you project an image onto in UV light, and the UV light chemically reacts to harden. Then the plate drops down and prints the next step. It's a chemical process, and as it drops down, the part they're making magically appears. And they're very fast compared to traditional printers, but they're limited in the number of the media you can actually make. They have to be chemically reactive, photoreactive, ultraviolet light, or the laser light they're using. Very fine detail. They can come out looking absolutely perfect. The thing is, they're not structural. They're not something, the materials aren't something you can't take it, put it on your car, just replace a piece. They're not
very strong.
They're not strong. But they're very powerful. Very powerful. Laser sintering is selective laser sintering is a laser beam where they introduce a powder, and the laser beam will actually put the powder in the spot and build the application as it goes up. Some of them are, they have kind of a gaseous form of vapor, and the laser goes around and basically it needs melting, and it will melt material and build the object. That's complete commercial. I look forward to when that gets available to us, but as I understand, there are a lot of health issues with it. The powder is so fine that they use that it's a health hazard. If you breathe it, it kills you. So it might be a while for it to come to us. The other one is a laser melting, where it just takes, it's more like a welding process where it feeds material in. And then there's an electron beam melt I haven't seen. What we are talking about, and what we can do, is called fused deposition. And here we have a couple pictures. Well, this one is it's here the stereolithography, the digital version. But this is a fluid, and it's printed on the surface of this, and as it's, the image is projected in layers, and as it pulls out of fluid, the hardened materials that was hardened by the laser come out, so it's like this draws an object up. It's pretty cool. It's very fast. Other ones the laser melt. It's the same thing, only there's a platform. It all starts with a blank platform. And it will lay a layer of aluminum dust. And the laser goes out and melts it in place. And it drops down, comes over like, and sweeps another layer. Laser melts that and drops down again. It keeps going like that. And then it drops down and builds the object. I continually put material over it and then outline it with a laser, which again is fairly fast. What we do is the fused deposition model, which this is a heated bed. This is called a hot end. That is the injector, and it works like a plotter. It moves out in an XY type pattern, lays a extrudes material according to the diameter of the injector, which is right here, which is 0.5 millimeter, and it injects it onto the surface of the plate, then raises up, does another layer, raises up, does another layer, and builds an object that way. But it has to mechanically move around and paint the surface. So it basically paints it layer by layer and builds it up. If there's an overhang, and the software gets pretty sophisticated, you have something that overhangs and doesn't have come in contact with the surface, that's over 45 degrees, it will actually build the scaffolding along the way to hold that up so we can build those objects. We've got a canvas here, don't have to have bottoms or the fill gaps. So that is what we're talking about. Now the other one is home CNC. One of the reasons why ATM is as popular as it was before is the movement of most telescope manufacturing to China. Entry-level telescopes are readily available, decent quality, and affordable. more so than in the past, entry-level into an FCT a number of years ago was $2,000 or $3,000 for an 8-inch SCT. I think $2,500 for an 8-inch SCT. You can get it doing a lot cheaper than that now. or in Europe. The other movement is affordable home CNC equipment. Again, the price point is driven by down by the Chinese who mass produce interesting CNC machines. The key to any CNC machine is what's its work volume? How big a thing can it actually make? Mine has a workspace of basically a woman's shoebox, 12 inches by 5.5 by 6. I can make anything that fits into that size. You can get them in 2, 3, or 4 axes, which is X, Y, Z, and A. Which is a rotation. So you have a piece of work that you can rotate on 3 axes. You can see another. The more axes you have, the more complex the components you can make. And the harder it is to. Now this is a CNC router. And if you're into ATM and you like working in wood, you can get these in the size of 4x8. It will go out, and you can either use a router or a laser to cut them. And the essence of what this means is when you built things by hand, in the old days you were lucky to maintain 1/16 of an inch accuracy, and these tools can get you 1/1000 of an inch accuracy. And that translates to more professional productions. It means that you can start to produce ATM doesn't have to be a compromise with a production system. You can actually make something of that quality yourself, or you're approaching that. This is a small one. These mills can run anywhere from these kind of mills that can do wood and light aluminum. That's something you can get into those for like $1,000. There's also within the maker community, maker movements, there are what's called maker spaces. And if you can go to maker spaces, and it's basically a place that you can join as a club member and use their equipment. But it's, a lot of them have the makerspace in Reston. As nice one, I've been there a number of times. They have a package to produce a 3D printer called a RipRap. And the interesting thing is that neat thing about 3D printers is 3D printers can make 3D printers. Most of them are, seriously, they are made out of 3D printable parts. I have a TAS 5, the new model is a TAS 6. I can make a TAS 6 with my TAS 5 if I want. I have to buy another TAS or get those, but I can make all the parts. And if there's a bug and they fix a part, they don't send you a part, they send you a file. You load the file and put the part and put it on. The maker community, and I use the term maker, it's kind of a new one, but ATMers have been makers all along. They're just people that like to make things. The maker community, there are avenues for interchange of parts. There are standards. There's a website called Thingiverse. You go on Thingiverse, and there are tens of thousands of parts people have designed and put out there, and you can download them and print them. Yes, you can download that and print it. A lot of people that make ATM parts go on Thingiverse. There's a couple of models out there for 3D printer, 100% 3D printable telescopes. I think that's absurd. You need metal, plastic can't do everything. When we were talking about the 3D printers, just by the rest of them, the ones that we use a plastic film that comes in spools. The original prototypes they were working with were handmade heating elements using, they were using lime from weed whackers. Heating weed whacker lime and melting it in extreme. It's like a big computerized glue gun. There are many different, in the realm that we're talking about, the deposition, this deposition stuff here, the fused deposition has, you can get dozens of different media and formats. Ours is a 3 millimeter diameter. It comes in a spool of about a kilogram or 4 kilograms. When you order, it costs maybe, depending on the material, 25 to, or the carbon fiber stuff, like $50, $60 for a spool. You can get plastic infused with carbon nanofibers to create more rigid stuff. There are plastics infused with metal that gives the metallic sheen that's kind of polishable. Different strengths, you can print nylon. You can print ABS, PLA. Some of them are food safe. PLA is a food safe.
There's PETG, there's all
sorts of things. There's a lot of them that are food safe, so you can actually make the containers. But you need a hotbed. These are little ovens. That platform is at, if this is ABS, that's about 100 degrees Celsius. And the print material is at about 235 is what I use for the brand. So this stuff is hot. And you can actually, when you turn it on, you can fry eggs in it if you want. There's a lot of, the software's gotten very sophisticated for building structures on to help pull things down to keep that from happening. Because it's plastic, it's molten materials, it expands and contracts. It's an open framework, but mine I have in an enclosed container. I have this. Because it has blowers and fans on here. It's all under computer control. When it's creating the structure, it has a cooling fan, and there's a profile for every filament. Some of them cool down naturally very quickly. Some of them take a while. And you can't go back and lay goo on top of goo. It's got a valley that has to harden it before it can lay another one. So there's little fans on here that, depending on the profile that you're using, will turn on the fan and cool down the material as you print. And depending on the variant, the material you're using and the speed you're printing, you get variance. A lot of plastic has water in it. ABS has water in it. Nylon has a huge amount of water. And if you have too much water, when you heat it, it pops and, you know, steam comes out and it will cause flaws in the print. I've gotten that under pretty good control in my house too. I moved to my new house. It's pretty good. The print's amazing there. MIT built a 3D printer that prints houses. They have, they have one. It's a boom and it goes out and it pours a plasticized concrete layer by layer and it will actually build a foundation in the day. And they're working on using this kind of deposition technology to build bases on the moon. Scoop up the dirt, make concrete out of it, start screwing and building structures. The International Space Station got its first 3D printer and it prints pieces. It prints pieces. It prints out the dough. And and this is an example of this is a result of a printer from the laser sintering. Okay. How do we move it? As far as difficulty goes, if you want it, what I'm talking, this is my first telescope I built. This is 100% 3D printed, with the exception of which is a Home Depot. There's got to be metal in the structure if you're gonna, and there are CNC parts in the back that plastic is not metal, so it flexes. So any good telescope needs is going to be a combination of processes. But this is a 6-inch. The last one I made was last part of me. I just finished this one yesterday. That's the focuser. That took about 3 hours. This guy takes about an hour and a half. These rings can take a period of time, depending on the quality. You can choose the quality, how thick do you want the layer to be, how thick, or if you want a really fine finish, and I like a nice finish, you can come up and look at it. I'll pass it a second round. This is
variable resolution.
Yeah, you get variable resolution. This was printed on the finest setting. You can see the layering, in it, so it's very fine. It's like 0.17 millimeters. And that makes it 6-7 hours. This is not a practical part of trying to produce it, but it's pretty good. The files, there's a process. You have a CAD package you're using to design. You can use Google Sketch, it's free. I use Rhino, which is a commercial package. It's absolutely amazing. You can create shapes and spin them, and it will produce beautiful three-dimensional objects. You take those and save them and export them as a mesh in an STL format. And what that is it's a digital. If you took something and took a like a nylon mesh and wrapped it around, that's kind of what it looks like. It's a three-dimensional representation of all the contours in the object. You create a mesh and then you send it to the 3D printer where you're to a product called, well, we use Cura, which is the one that BuzzBox uses. It pulls it in and you set parameters, how thick a layer do I want. It doesn't print solids. You can have it print solids, but you can tell it what fill density you want. It will build the outside frame and then a structure inside to hold it together. So you can make it light and weak or heavier and stronger. You've got a lot of parameters. How thick it is, what the feed rates are, that sort of thing. And then that gets into the computation of the time. You can do a fast print of thick layers to make a prototype in a fraction of the time it takes to do one that's detailed like this one. So they can take, for large ones, some people take days. but I don't do parks that size. Mine usually 2-3 hours for a park. The accuracy of 3D printing is not as good as a mill. The mills will get you 1,000th of an inch accuracy. 3D printers are still working on it because you're talking about molten metals that expand and contract when you're cooled. Dimensional stuff can be difficult to achieve. But you can get 4,000th of an inch accuracy. I've been able to get it on some parts. Which is still better than a saw. And a lot of it, and the finished part isn't really finished. You're going to want to, some people will sand them down, sand the surface to get contours. There's some artifacts left from the printing process. I think it's attractive. So, what are the pros? 3D printers, easy. Not easy to get good results. It's taken a long time for me to get the quality out of it that I've gotten out. Very rewarding. It allows you, this resulted in 2 trash cans full of tries. A spool goes a long way, but I've printed each of these pieces at least 6 times to get it the way I want. That's really, there's a lot of things like, this is adjustment screws. Well, you don't have screws threaded in the plastic. You create a slot in the CAD, the size and the form of the nut, a nut, a steel nut. And after you print it, you take that nut and slide it in there. Now you've got a threaded metal contact in your plastic for that thread to work on. So that gives it resilience and strength. And along the lines of ATMing, you can build the telescope you want. This is an FI, and it's got 50-millimeter secondary, which is kind of oversized, but I like a rich field. I like low-power, rich field astronomy mods. If you do planetary, you really want a smaller secondary because it increases contrast. So when you buy a telescope, you have to make a decision what kind of secondary you're going to do. If you're innovative, you can build it with a neodymium magnet and a plate, so I can swap out my secondary anytime I want. I can take this out and put a small one in planetary. I'll put this in and do a rich field. I'll pass this around the current level of print I can get. This is the best I've gotten so far. It has a very powerful neodymium magnet welded on the end, so it might stick to things on you. So if jewelry comes back, you can have it because no good jewelry is magnetic. But it's spring-loaded. It's got springs printed inside, so there's a tension spring that holds the secondary mirror in place, and then the screws give you the adjustment, so you can actually pull it a little bit. It's got a nice smooth feel to it. CNC machines are interesting, but whereas a 3D printer, you can pretty casual with it. You've got to print, you've got to design, make sure your bed's clean, you've got the stuff in there, you can fire off a print and walk away. CNC machines are very powerful. They're very heavy because if you have a spinning cutter head and you're going through 2 inches of cold steel at 20 inches a second, you need a lot of torque. These machines are more than happy to devour themselves whole. When you design something, you have to be meticulous in how you set it up. You've got to be the good systems. You'll have a simulator where you run it with a simulation of your system where it will check the software if the cutter is going to make contact with something that it isn't supposed to, because it doesn't care. I've had to replace a number of parts because the little mill, I went through the gearing, weighs 65 pounds, but the motors have 400 foot-pounds of torque. That can twist anything. I was milling a block of ABS plastic, and I did a tool change, and I forgot to start the mill. the cutter. It shoved it into the plastic and proceeded to plow through the plastic. And it is coming out like water weight as it's pushing this thing through the plastic. Meanwhile, the column, this guy, he's got a, this guy has a single nut on the back, which I luckily did not have down too tight, and it starts to go the other direction. So the whole mill's going, column sitting there plowing, pushing the cold end mill through plastic, and it did it. It ruined my spindle head. It no longer was 10,000 of an inch accuracy after that. I had to order a new one. So if that were metal, it would have been worse. But there's feedback mechanisms in this mill. It's a closed loop system. So if it will print what it was told to print, and if it jams or something, it'll stop. But for some reason, it didn't stop the ABS. It was more happy. So it's very, you can do a lot of really good work with these machines, and you can get into a good CNC mill that can make parts for telescopes about $1,000, $1,500. And it's fun, but you got to be on your game when you use it. You cannot go do it when you're tired, because if you make a mistake, it will make you pay. But they're great. Next step is DIY electronics. I'm building a frame of gears. I've been two new means of production. 3D printing, you can make parts of your telescope. CNC, where you can make other parts of your telescope you want. Your choice how you break that up and what you use. With all of this, with your SCTs and the like, you want them. You need electronics. You've got two types of boards. These are computer boards. These are Arduinos. Arduinos are the open source process control computers that I'll pass one around for you to take a look at. This is a micro and this is a mini. They're about that big. They run code. They can drive stepper motors and turn on lights and read sensors, temperatures, make decisions, do all kinds of things.
and communicate
with your computer. This one is called a lily pad. It's an Arduino you can sew into clothing, and you can weave conductive wires into your cloth, into this, so you can have sensors and clothes, and it's machine washable. I have no reason for astronomers to do that, or then if you want to check your pulse rate. So why are we interested in these? I'll go forward. Here we have a set of Arduinos. That's a little teeny micro Arduino. This is a down here single board computer. It's a little bigger than an Arduino, but it's a full computer. This one is a Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi 3 has a quad-core ARM processor, four cores, gigabyte of memory, Ethernet, USB, HDMI out. It can do everything a small computer can do. For $35. The Arduino has pins on the side for interfacing to shields that you can plug into it to do different things. So basically, on a process control computer, you have a sensor, which is reading the environment. There is you have sensors that gather information about the environment. It brings that information to the computer, goes through a logical process, and the result is to run actuators, which can be motors. So it gives a way for it. These are designed to create machines that interact with the environment that you're dealing with. If you have a computer and you don't want do on your, you can take an Arduino, plug in a sensor that monitors humidity, barometric pressure. It can compute the dew point, take the temperature of the take the temperature of wherever you put your temperature sensor inside your telescope, and if it's within a few degrees of dew point, turn on the fans automatically. You can do that, and you can build that in an afternoon. Arduinos were designed by an Italian engineer in Italy for teaching computers to children. They have kids in junior high working with these things. Because that's what it was made for. It's a very simple process. You don't have to be a big program developer. This is minimal programming. It's a little logical. It's something you can actually get a hold of. They call the language for the Arduino Scratch, but it's actually C. It's macros in it. You just write very simple code. After you've written your code, you upload it from your PC directly to Arduino, and when it powers up, it automatically starts running its code, and it does what you want to do. So when I got one, the first thing I did was build a Arduino, two servo motors that I attached arms to with foam bats on them, and an ultrasonic sensor that I went and I designed to protect my bird feeder. And it sits out, and I strapped it onto the rail next to the bird feeder. And when the squirrels came down, and within the vision of, within 3 feet of the acoustic sensor, it started wailing away at it. It was the greatest thing I've made. You can do anything with these, anything in your imagination.
Your advice for kids is actually use the Arduino for a satellite.
Yep, the satellites, robots. You can go down to Micro Center and they have kits for these, and you can get them with a bunch of sensors already built in, and you can use this stuff for it. They can run motors, they can run stepper motors, which gives you a degree of precision. The 3D printer we use and the riprap ones use an Arduino to drive it. The whole XYZ making the device running. It's an Arduino running it. It's a $35 computer. The performance, the machines run in megahertz, like 16 megahertz. They're not gigahertz machines. They have memory in thousands of bytes, not megabytes, gigabytes. But you don't need that for this. This is an interface to an environment. There are almost an infinite number of sensors available for Arduinos. You can have battery powered on your computer. I've made one. I prototyped a red light for my for observing. It has a little sensor. I walk up and the light automatically illuminates the desk, and I can do what I want. I walk up and turn the light up. So it does. It's great. Took me 10 minutes to put together. Your computer that runs in the gigahertz is an exercise in wasted power. Any of these computers, the desktop computers, can run the payroll for General Motors in 10 minutes. They're incredibly powerful, and what do they spend their time doing? Making pretty pictures, flashing lights, etc. These are basic machines. They do exactly what they're designed to do. You power them on, they start doing their thing. You power them off, they stop. You upload it, flash memory, it's there forever. You turn it on, it just starts running. They're very reliable. And this one here is an Arduino, or is a Raspberry Pi with a display on it. You can stack it and make your own tablets. The power of an Arduino or your Raspberry Pi is basically the performance of a tablet. It's the same as a computer. It's just a board with a tablet CPU on it. Here is RoboScope. We built RoboScope a number of years ago. This is what it looked like inside. Windows box for running the Astronomy software, a Linux box that had 500, half a gig of memory, Celeron processor, hard drive. This board, this thing right here, has a sensor, a commercial digital I/O and sensor interface for A to D, analog to digital conversion. It attached two sensors we had on here. Here's a weather boom. This was a rain sensor. There's a cloud sensor. Anyone gets an award if they can tell me how the cloud sensor works. The Linux box ran scripts that would read all those sensors and make a decision about whether or not they were going to commit. It's going to rain, it's not going to rain, open or close. And it worked reliably as long as there was power to it. It worked really great. Today, you can do it on that. Matter of fact, all the real processing can be done on strictly one Arduino. With a couple of sensor interfaces. Or that, if I wanted to integrate it to, I've got one, I'll pass it around so you get an idea how big these are. But these computers can replace that entire cabinet with the exception of a Windows box. This is this is the largest Arduino. It's called Omega. This one has about 60 ports for different sensors. They are not difficult, difficult to use. I encourage you to explore this. This one is called that's my personal favorite. That's an Odroid, which has 8 processors, 2 gig of memory, and it runs Linux like a workstation. Yes, you. Very powerful. I am building an observatory home, and this is basically a combination. I'm using a lot of it right now. Here's projects on the internet. If you go out and Google Arduino telescope, you're going to see a lot of work. Here's a guy that has a motor focuser he built. This is a laser pointer on a axis, so you can give it the object you want and it'll point to it. Here's a computer controlled telescope. Another one, this is an Arduino being used on the Large Hadron Collider. Engineers had to, actually this is running a gamma ray detector. It's doing counts on gamma ray detector. they're used everywhere. And they're very easy to use. And once you get into it and playing with them, you just add more features. And, it's a real joy. What does this mean for you? Those SCTs that you have that are going to have fragile electronics in the future that may not be able to be repaired. What does a 3D printer, a CNC milling machine, and an SCT have in common? They're fundamentally the same device. It's a computer driving motors to position something on a coordinate system. X, Y, Z axis to make something. Telescope, right? Essentially, declination. Same thing, same stepper motors. You can take an Arduino and patch it into your SCT and run it. Open source projects to use Arduinos to run telescopes, including SCTs that are broken processors. You can patch it in and resume working with open source hardware. That is all within your purview. The other is sensors. You can buy any sensor to do anything you want. One of the things I played around with, I have a Dobsonian I built that was, it's a suitcase telescope, it's blue, and struts are carbon composite hunting arrows. I had a star party, it's pretty neat, you can see right through it. At night it disappears. I've had been star parties walked away, and had to wait till morning because I couldn't find it. Flashlight shined right through it. I had, so I've designed a circuit that you can hang on it. And when I walk away from the telescope, it turns a little light on. And when I walk up to the eyepiece, it turns it off. You can have fans on your, cooling your fan. Fans cause vibration in your telescope. You put a sensor at the eyepiece. When you walk up to the eyepiece, it'll turn off the fan automatically. You can observe it once. When you walk away, it turns it right back on. These are all easy things to do. You pick them in an afternoon. The circuitry in the afternoon, print the design, a case to hold it so it has like a commercial quality and it's not a rat's nest. You can actually have a little box of wires you plug into. You can print the box. Do the whole thing, make what is basically a commercial quality thing from home. Everything you need is there. You can, with what I've gone through, you can machine parts for your telescope. You can print parts to augment it. You can 3D print a holder that will hold your iPhone over your eyepiece so you can take pictures of your telescope. There's dozens of copies of those. You don't need to buy a 3D printer. If you have a network set up in a club like our one I or someone else has 3D printers, you can just design it, nail file, I can print it out, and give it to them. And this is things we can do in the club. There's a lot here for things you can do. you can hook these up. All of these are Arduinos. You can hook them up wireless so they can talk directly to your laptop. They can be wireless, they can be Bluetooth. You can even add security. And have RFID, so if you don't have the right RFID tag, you can block the eyepiece. I mean, you can look through it if you want to do that. I don't know why you would want to, but you can get totally stoned and do anything you want. So, this is my telescope.
Yep.
We're done. If you want to come and take a look at it and ask any questions, I'd be happy to answer any you have. And if you're interested in getting into a printer, contact myself and I'll be a volunteer Arlen. But yes, it's cool. And the next star party we have, I'll probably have this there and you can actually play me. So give it a shot. Ran out of time. I've got thousands of sensors here. I have methane detectors. And you can not let people to your set off an alarm if someone's flagellant approaches. I'm not kidding, you can do anything you want. I actually got that. And to build a little robot that rolled around the house and find my dog poop. it was pretty good at finding it, but it didn't know where it was and it ran through it. every project has a fault. All the stuff that I'm trying to emphasize, this is easy stuff. It's really, really simple. You can buy a kit off Amazon or Micro Center with basic parts. You can get it doing things you want in an hour, 2 hours. All the code's already written. You can Google anything you're trying to make, and it'll come up with hundreds of lists of code and examples already existing. The community is so big that the amount of information is mind-boggling. Anybody interested in doing that, let me know. I can get with you and get